Hachette Audio presents Man Repeller, Seeking Love, Finding Overalls. Written by Leandra Medine, read by Leandra Medine. For AB, my parents, and the chat room. Author's note.
Well, here you have it. My brain in tens of thousands of words crafted to display an unfiltered glance into my thinly veiled by chiffon thoughts. In order to protect the identities of characters crucial to the development of this book of essays, I have changed several names and on the rare occasion, profession and geographic location as well. You can rest assured, however, that each and every sartorial object depicted, dramatized, and described in the forthcoming pages is as authentic a nod to my memory as it is to the clothing that shapes it. Also, thanks for buying me.
Let's get a drink when you're done.
The tent dress. I was lying through my teeth when I told Marla that a girl's first kiss is like watching fireworks, only even more magical. I'm still not sure what compelled me to say that to my cousin's 13-year-old daughter when I had been so resentful of my mother's wrongly romantic assertions about knowing when you know and feeling right at the very pit of your existence. What is the pit of your existence? I should have told Marla what it's really like. Slimy, awkward, and never ever as climactic as the movies that impregnate and then abandon your heart want you to believe. But maybe, too, my opinion was biased. I didn't know much about the male species as a kindergartner, but I did know that I had a crush on a boy named Kevin. His hair was a silky bowl that almost always looked like it had been freshly cut. He didn't speak very much and often came to school with red boils on his arms, which prompted our teacher, Miss Sherry, to send him home. I always felt a sense of emptiness when he left, as though my existence at school was pointless and as though I'd wasted my good plaid dress or clean white turtleneck for nothing. On a Tuesday morning that I was certain he would be in school, our mothers had been on the phone the night before and I overheard mine say she'd see his at pickup the next day, I walked into Miss Sherry's classroom feeling particularly good about myself. Just after the previous night's phone conversation, I had successfully lured my mother into letting me wear my favorite dress to school. It was reserved exclusively for special occasions, such as Rosh Hashanah dinner at my decidedly highbrow grandmother's house. But standing in my closet, I nudged at my mother's knee, explaining why she should let me wear the dress to school. Even at 6 years old, I understood the fundamental importance of calculating cost per wear. In a final fit signaling the brink of exhausted defeat, losing to a child is hard, I will give her that, my mom tried to threaten me. "If you dirty it," she warned, "I'm not cleaning it." It was difficult to take her scare tactics seriously. She diligently tried to instill the do what you incorrectly want and you're on your own ethos in all four of her children. But when push came to shove, we were never on our own. At the slice of a paper cut, there she was with Neosporin band-aids and a phone at arm's length should the emergency room need advance warning that we were coming. "Oh my gosh, what a lovely dress," Miss Sherry offered when I got to school that Tuesday. It was lovely indeed. In a distinct hue of burgundy that predated the oxblood craze of 2012, my knee-length, tent-shaped dress featured a Peter Pan collar adorned with embroidered grape leaves and housed an entire layer of tulle in its underbelly. "I know, isn't it the best?" I gushed. Not very humble, no, but I was, after all, wearing the dress because I had won an argument about it. Didn't that score me bragging rights? Hopefully, as Miss Sherry did, Kevin would find it lovely and then subsequently find me lovely, too. As I walked to my cubby to put my jacket and pink patent leather knapsack away and to fix my side-parted, side-clipped, shoulder-length hair, my two best friends, Sarah and Rebecca, walked over to me. I waited for them to compliment my fancy dress, but instead they just looked at me dumbfounded. "You look like a baby," Sarah said. She was wearing a gray sweater tucked into a leather miniskirt, her hair in a half pony that looked like a chignon purchased in the sale aisle at Duane Reade. Rebecca, donning a similar hairstyle, concurred, and my ego fell to the ground. They were right. I did look like a baby. I guess that's the thing about age-appropriate dressing. It's inappropriate. There was no way Kevin would care about my dress. How could I have been so silly? A feeling foreign to me at the time, self-consciousness, reared its vicious head. For the rest of the day, I did everything I could to cover the dress. I took my jacket out of my cubby and put it back on. They made fun of me. I got hot, so I took it off and put it around my waist. They made fun of that, too. This was a no-win situation. I looked at the clock around 11:50 a.m., fretfully dreading what would happen in 10 minutes when recess would start and I would have no choice but to face my friends again. Normally, during recess, Rebecca, Sarah, and I would play house with Kevin. They had crushes on him too, but I was almost certain mine predated theirs and as such was much stronger. Kevin always played the dad, and the three of us, or rather the two of them, would fight almost every day over who got to play the mom. I wanted to be the mom too, but I'm a lover, not a fighter, so I typically took the role of child to avoid conflict. By then, I knew that on this day, the girls would unquestionably liken my outfit to the role anyway. I already felt the lump in my throat signaling the imminent cry of defeat. I was trying to prepare myself when Sarah said it. "You have to play the baby because you're dressed up as one already." I wasn't all that confrontational and thus allowed the following series of events to unfold as they would, with me sitting in a corner while they fought over who should be the mother and why. "I'm the oldest," Sarah said. "So, my mom said I'm going to be the best mom there is. I know how to cook vegetables," Rebecca retorted. The kitchen in our game was Fisher-Price, for heaven's sake. I put my head down, though still paying distinct attention to their ridiculous squabble, when I saw a set of knees clad in khaki slacks bend and land directly adjacent to my own. I looked up and there he was, a rash-free Kevin. He moved from in front of me to directly next to me, and I felt his scaly hand clench mine. The world stopped. I couldn't offer much attention to how coarse and unpleasant his grasp felt because my heart was beating so damn fast that I had to wonder if it might explode out of my chest. I was almost certain that I was seconds away from peeing in my pants. Sarah and Rebecca stopped arguing to acknowledge our budding romance, and as they looked over, unquestionable rage in their eyes, he kissed me on the cheek. Now I was certain I had peed in my pants, but I was too busy becoming a woman superior to both Sarah and Rebecca in spite of my childish dress to attend to that situation. We never ended up playing house that day, but it was clear that in matters of who got to play whom, I was most definitely the mom. "How did it feel?" Sarah asked amicably, as though she hadn't just hours before stabbed my pride in the heart. "You're so lucky," Rebecca added. "I know," I agreed. My aversion toward modesty struck again, if only for 20 minutes, before both Sarah and Rebecca resumed their native positions as evil best friends and plagued me with cooties. For the rest of recess, my entire class, led by my two best friends, sang, "Leandra has cooties, Leandra has cooties." It was debilitating, really. At afternoon snack time, a few hours after Kevin had kissed me, Sarah asked why he did it. Who does that? And Sarah had no problem sharing the details of a private conversation she'd held with Kevin and his friends. Apparently, his friends had dared him to kiss me when they saw me sitting in a corner, the tulle on the inside of my dress creating a thick, poofy puddle around me. "He wanted to give her cooties," Kevin's idiotic friend Zachary had chimed in. Sarah and Rebecca didn't talk to me for the rest of the day. And though my morale was now a bit lower and I was almost certain that the stress and abandonment had caused a rash to break out on my forearms, I didn't blame the yet unfolding disaster on Kevin. Whether or not the kiss had been sincere, it was the most magical lip-to-cheek interaction I had ever encountered. And also the only, unless we're cataloging parental affection. I didn't blame it on my friends either. No, if anyone was to blame, it was my dress. When I got home that day, I ran to my bedroom, ripped the dress off my body, and proceeded to stomp all over it, wearing only my white wool tights and navy blue patent leather Mary Jane flats. Hysterical, I explained to my mother that I never wanted to dress like a baby again. That puddle of tulle that elicited the kiss offered up a generous serving of fresh, squeezed humiliation. Why hadn't I just worn a white turtleneck and riding pants? My mom looked confused and even hurt. It had been not even 24 hours since I'd begged her to let me wear that dress. But before we could resolve my despair, she noticed the unusual red blotches on my limbs. "What's on your hands?" she interrupted my fit to ask, as the rash had quite visibly spread from my forearms to my hands. "They're itchy," I told her as she pulled my arms forward, examining the boils erupting on my skin. She smelled them, though I'm still not sure why, and then affirmatively shrieked, "Oh my God, Leandra, you have chicken pox!" She quickly removed what clothing I still had on and grabbed latex gloves from her intimates drawer, pulling them onto her hands. "Don't touch anything, especially your face," she cautioned, but why did she have my pediatrician's gloves in her underwear drawer? She drew me a bath, filled it with baking soda, and while supervising my bath time, asked me to tell her what I'd done that day, detail by detail. By the time I was through, my mom assured me that Sarah and Rebecca were obviously just jealous and that I shouldn't fault my most favorite dress for their actions. At last, my symphony began playing in harmony again. Of course they were jealous. Who wouldn't be jealous of a burgundy dress that lends no favors to the female figure and yet still incites a most romantic first kiss? I guess that's the thing about a first kiss. It doesn't really matter why you get it. What's important is that you have it. And as for Kevin, what an irresponsible mother he has, I later heard my mom tell my dad. She sends her son to school in the final stages of the chickenpox and doesn't think to tell the teacher? Then my daughter has to catch it? I'm calling the principal. Indeed, it seemed Kevin most certainly had given me cooties. I told my mom I hated him for it, that I couldn't believe he'd made such a fool of me. But the truth is, I was pretty thankful. Chickenpox certainly meant I had to spend at least the rest of the week at home, which thereby meant a lot of daytime television.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.